Hurricane Dorian's destruction in the Bahamas and what that might mean as the storm makes its way up the east coast of the United States. New images in today show the catastrophe in the Bahamas. What were family homes and quaint resort towns? Pulverized, pummeled. The U.S. Coast Guard and the U.S. Customs and Border Protection have joined the Bahamian rescue mission, searching by air and by land for any signs of life. The death toll now stands at 7, but officials expect that number to rise. As Dorian moves north, Florida beaches are getting pelted by outer bands. Dorian could then slam the Carolinas. Port cities such as Charleston, South Carolina, are bracing for near-record storm surge. Let's start with what Dorian has done. CNN's Patrick Oppmann just got a look at the utter destruction of a key airport in the Bahamas.
We are on the runway at the Freeport Airport. It has been inaccessible for days. There was a river between the rest of the city and this airport. It was completely underwater. It looked like the waves were crashing. Waves were crashing against this airport. Look how destroyed it is right now. Just about every side, 8 feet to 10 feet up, has been leveled, ripped in, torn in. Look at it now. I don't recognize it. There is not a wall standing. You think about the need this island has right now for a functioning airport to get injured people out, to get supplies in. And this airport right now is completely destroyed. I've never seen anything like it in my life. This is complete and utter devastation like I've never seen. Jose's gonna point the camera over here. Look at this, that's a wheel. This is the underside of a plane. This is what's left of the wing. You think of the force required to throw a plane from the runway into a terminal. Anybody was here, I don't know how they would have survived. I've seen a lot of damage on this island. This is the absolute most devastated area I have seen so far. It will be impossible for anybody who is injured or just wants to get off the island to leave from here. Aid will not be able to come in to this part of the airport, into this airport at all, because it's just a debris field now. So if help is gonna come, it's gonna have to come through some other way, boats, another airfield, but this is really the only air. This is the only airfield for this island, and it is in utter ruins.
It's Patrick Oppmann at the Freeport Airport, which is in Grand Bahama in the Bahamas. Let's turn to Dorian's threat to the United States right now. With me, CNN meteorologist Jennifer Gray. And Jennifer, the threat appears to be more along the Carolina coast than to Florida.
You're exactly right. It pretty much paralleled the coast of Florida. I mean, Florida was playing with fire for a couple of days. It could have gotten just a little bit closer. We would have seen much bigger impacts across Florida. But luckily, it did just parallel the coast. Of course, we are looking at South Carolina, North Carolina now. I think that's where the biggest threat lies. The storm still has 105 mile per hour winds, gusts of 125. It's still a Category 2, moving at 9 miles per hour, so is moving much faster than it was through the Bahamas. Here's a closer look. You can see right there the center of the storm off the coast of Jacksonville, and as it continues its northward journey, we'll continue to see the rain bands as well as the winds start to pick up in places like Savannah and Charleston. That's really where we're going to be concerned the most. But we are still getting those rain bands pushing on shore in Florida as well. It's going to pull away from there, make its journey to the north, and then eventually the east. The concern with Charleston is it's very vulnerable. It's low-lying, and any surge of water that comes in, which they'll get quite a bit of storm surge, can flood Charleston very easily. So we'll be talking about a Category 2 in this area throughout the midday range tomorrow, and then by the evening pulling away. But we could be looking at record or near record tides for the Charleston area, second to just Hugo. And that's huge if people lived in Charleston during Hugo and remember. Cape Hatteras, the Outer Banks, we are looking at a Category 2 there by the end of the week. So, Jake, this is far from over. I know we've been talking about this storm for a long time. Some people have fatigue with this storm, but it is still very serious. And folks in the Carolinas need to take it seriously.
All right, Jennifer Gray, thank you so much. She was talking about Charleston there. Let's go to CNN's Brian Todd, who made his way to Charleston, South Carolina. And Brian, As you heard Jennifer Gray just say, that's the low country, a low-lying city at sea level. And that's the big problem as Dorian approaches.
Absolutely right, Jake. We're going to show you an illustration of that. This city very vulnerable because of how low it is to sea level. This is a road right next to the Ashley River, but right also next to downtown. Just a short time ago, we got a short burst of rain, the outer edges of the storm, and a little bit of high tide, and this whole area was washed over with water. This isn't technically flooding. This is just standing water. But look how vulnerable this low-lying area is. We're going to avoid the cars here and show you, though. Over here is the Ashley River. Just look at where that river comes up where the marshes hit, and the marshes pretty much come right to the road here. That is what makes this area so vulnerable. They say that the storm is really going to be feeling the effects here in the next 24 to 36 hours. They have had 360,000 plus people evacuate from the coastal areas of South Carolina. Jake, almost half of them have evacuated from the Charleston area. And you talk to local officials that we've been talking to all day who say that what really speaks to the mindset of people here is that experience with Hurricane Hugo. 30 years ago this month, Hurricane Hugo came up the Charleston Harbor as a Cat 4. It hit just a little bit north of Charleston, and it was utter devastation for weeks, they said. National Guard troops on the streets for weeks, power outages for weeks. One city official told me a short time ago he was here during that period. He left, and when he came back, he said, "I didn't talk to one person who didn't regret staying through that storm." So Hurricane Hugo speaks to the mindset of these people and why they want to leave Charleston. It's a little bit unlike the people in Florida, who many of them you talk to say, "I can ride this out." In South Carolina, in this area, in Charleston, they've had so many experiences with bad hurricanes, also in recent years. This is going to be basically the third punishing hurricane to hit this place in 3 years, Jake, and they're wondering how much more they can take here.
All right, Brian Todd in Charleston, South Carolina, thanks so much. I want to go back to the Bahamas, specifically to CNN's Patrick Oppmann, who's live for us in Freeport. And Patrick, it's hard to get a signal right now out from there, so crossing our fingers here. Tell us more about the destruction you saw today.
Well, first we tried to go out to the area where we were. You may remember yesterday where they were doing the boat rescues, the jet skis and the boats. And amazingly enough, the water there has all receded. We saw boats that were thrown up on people's lawns. There are still rescues going on the far east end of this island. It's still underwater. It's absolutely impossible for us to get there either by boat or car. We saw Coast Guard helicopters flying overhead, and we saw lots and lots of people coming in this area where there are hundreds of homes to survey the damage, to see if their neighbors, family, or just their friends are in those homes, essentially seeing who's still alive, Jake. A lot of people, when they came and saw their homes that they were completely gutted, and every home here was underwater, people had tears in their eyes. What can you say? Then we had heard that the airport was even worse than previously had been advertised, and we went out to the airport and saw, I know you played some of that material, just total destruction. I mean, whole planes, Cessnas and Pipers, thrown around like little toys. There was a wing with a wheel still connected that had somehow gone into one of the terminals at the airport. The international terminal we couldn't get into because we were told it was too dangerous to go in. It's still standing, but like the entire airport, it was underwater for several days. So we are starting to get a better picture, if not a complete picture, of the destruction here, and it's worse than we had thought.